Basically, that's what they had to say. But let me start with you, Steve, on where we are today. We do know that as per the Constitution, I know you're one that follows the law as an advocate, and you look at things from the perspective and the prism of a predictable path that is given by the Constitution. Now, that predictable path is that on Tuesday, we have the swearing in of the president. But on the other hand, we have an opposition who are saying that, look, we were not satisfied, we did not even participate, and we do not recognize the election of President Uhuru Kenyatta. What's the way forward?
Thank you, Gitonga. The swearing in is a legal consequence of an election, because Article 141 of the Constitution says the swearing in of the president-elect. Mm. So there has to be an election, which happened on the 26th of October, and it's also the consequence of the contestation in court and the subsequent validation of that election. So this will happen as a matter of course, as is stated by the Constitution. But what is important is that the other activities that may happen around the swearing in. I want to downplay any parallel activity that may happen on the Tuesday, because the only swearing in known in law will happen in Kasarani, and that will be because of Uhuru Kenyatta, who was declared the winner and ultimately confirmed by the Supreme Court. Now, if NASA wants perhaps to conduct a parallel swearing in, that will not be a swearing in within the terms of the Constitution, and it must be viewed as part of the posture, political posture, to mock the presidency of Uhuru Kenyatta. I don't think it's more than that. I'm sure they understand that, but if they were to escalate the actions beyond mocking the presidency, then we will have to assess it step by step and see if then now, what does it say in terms of the law? Does it really violate the law? Because if you look at the penal code, there are offenses such as subversion of the Constitution, personification of the presidency, and also treason. These are offenses that may broadly be interpreted to match any of the actions that NASA may take. Although I want also the president to appreciate the challenges that we live in. Gitonga, remember, during the electioneering period, we decried the inability of the political class to be bound by the law, that they thought that they are sort of immune to the legal processes.
They're above the law.
They operate within the law when they want, and they operate outside the law when they want, with the consequence that the people that support them, the NASA base, the Jubilee base, Kenyans have not really reached a level where they can say that they want to hold their leaders accountable and say, what you're about to do is obviously outside the law. So it will be interesting to see how Jubilee will react. But I can tell you, Gitonga, for sure, that in this particular time, the coming week, silence is key. If the president and the Jubilee could just react by just observing, and not deploying excessive force, that may have a more beneficial approach. Because if people want to do a mock swearing in, just watch them from TV.
Let them go ahead,
smile, because you know the exercise of state power can only be done through the formal channels under the Constitution. And so far, right now, those channels are within the Jubilee administration.
Bernard, Steve says that he downplays the whole, whatever else that may be taking place apart from the ceremony. However, we cannot ignore the fact that if the figures that were given by IEBC are anything to go by, during August 8th election and the 26th, there is a critical mass that is in support of NASA. Can we really downplay what they have to do?
Okay, thank you, Gitonga. I hold the view that in this country, everybody is bound by the Constitution, and everybody is supposed to operate within the four corners of the Constitution. And as Steve has clearly indicated, the only swearing in that is known and legally, or the one that is mandated by the Constitution, is the one that will be held by the president-elect, Uhuru Kenyatta. But the opposition, as I said earlier, indicated clearly that they did not recognize the election of Uhuru Kenyatta, having boycotted the 26th election, and they have gone ahead to agitate for a fresh election. And that's something that, you know, is not foreseen in the near future. So I think the Constitution as it is now, it allows the opposition to go ahead with their political activities, but as much as they operate within the confines, within the four corners of the constitution. Mm-hmm. And I'm seeing a scenario where we are going to have a running battle in the, on Tuesday, because the opposition will have to invite people, hold a rally, and this rally might, overshadow the ceremony that is expected to be held on in Kasarani. Mm-hmm. So I think the government or the state machinery is not going to allow the opposition to mobilize large crowds in town, which might overshadow the main event. And by doing that, we realize that both international and local media will be focusing on the NASA activities and or giving very little attention mm-hmm. to the presidency. Mm-hmm. But I think, in my own view, if the president and the government of Kenya realizes that the opposition, what they are doing is just a mockery, it's just a mock, swearing in, then they can just allow them to go on.
To go on, so you hold the same. Now, Steve, yes. The other thing that is expected is that as Raila was returning from Zanzibar, we do know that there's been wind. There's a big announcement to be made tomorrow by NASA. Now, we already have a framework of what NASA is planning. We already know that they're planning an economic boycott, which they've already begun, by boycotting certain companies which they feel are friendly to the government. We also do know that they're coming up with the People's Assembly. What other announcement can there be, really?
I think the strategy by NASA is going to be a disruptive one, because remember, this election has left us deeply divided, mm-hmm. In the sense that one section of the country is celebrating that finally we are past the electoral process, and truly we are, mm-hmm. and that we have a president and he's going to be sworn in, and then he's going to assume the reins of power. And we must understand the supporters of Jubilee. Mm-hmm. We can't fault them for celebrating Uhuru's swearing in. But equally, there's a critical population that did not even go to the election. You know, maybe in terms of strategy, NASA could be thinking, was it a mistake to boycott the election? But the fact is this: now you have a president elected. Well, you boycotted. Mm. So then it will take a bit of time. The political activity will take a bit of time before people come to the reality that the country will ultimately have to move on. Mm-hmm. So then we can expect that NASA will continue their program of action, what they are calling the program of action, mm-hmm. which basically is to mock the presidency, to delegitimize it. But I want to pray and ask Uhuru Kenyatta, if he's distracted by what NASA is doing, then he'll miss the point. Because once he's sworn in, he approaches the inner sanctum of power to serve the people of Kenya, and he must focus on the things that divide this country and address those issues. Perhaps run away with the issues, areas of concern, mm-hmm. what is being raised by NASA, and address them, preempt them and address them in a consultative, deliberative, and negotiated approach. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you cannot stop what NASA wants to do. For instance, if NASA wants to continue the assemblies, and I said before, and we've already seen the Kitui High Court, the enactment of the passage of motions on the People's Assemblies itself is not unconstitutional. It is the contents of those motions that would be unconstitutional. If you pass a bill or a law that offends national legislation, remember, under the Constitution, county assemblies, Mr. Gitonga, cannot pass legislations that conflict or contradict national legislations. Mm-hmm. They're supposed to break down national laws, interpret them to context-specific to their situation. Mm. And they cannot also pass laws that contradict the Constitution, because those laws will be held to be invalid. I would like the government, especially because I saw Eric Rai, they're trying to comment on the legality. I'd rather he doesn't do that, because there are Kenyans who will read those bills and someone will go to court, as they've already done in Kitui. If these assemblies pass bills that are, on the face of it, deemed to be illegal, to be unconstitutional, they will be challenged in court, and that matter will be dealt with at that level. Mm-hmm. The mass action or the demos, that will require a lot of innovation in government, because in Kenya we have seen before that Kenyans, we have a challenge in terms of organizing peaceful, violent-free demonstrations.
Correct.
Both because of the organizers and also because of government, the nature of excessive response in containing those demos. Mm-hmm. I want to pray and plead with Jubilee administration that if they feel that there's a reason to contain the demos, the better approach is to go to court under Article 24, Sub-Article 3, demonstrate reasons why you want to ban demonstrations in the CBD, mm-hmm. for instance, and then the court will allow that, and then you'll be putting NASA to task that, listen, we have a court order that says that you can't hold demos every day. Then you can enforce that court order, but don't act. You can't rely on raw power
or fear as a strategy for governance. Mm-hmm. Governance under the Constitution, under Article 10, must be participatory, must be consultative in nature. Mm. I want to also ask the President to actively be the first person to reach out to Raila Odinga. You know, most of this, our history, Gitonga, if you look at the history, where we've come from as a country, although we have had difficult challenges or maybe contestations, but the principles, when they reach out to each other, we've been able to unlock the stalemate. Mm. I don't think Raila is naive to think that this Uhuru and Ruto will easily resign. Because, you know, as politicians, when you contest an election,
you
do it to win. Yeah, and once you've been declared the winner, mm. and the court has affirmed that, the incentive to stay there cannot, I mean, it's just a common sense issue. Mm. So then, if he calls Raila Odinga and says, this was a game, mm. you know, to try and see who is going to rise to serve Kenyans, mm. whether I made a right move or a wrong move, or whether you made the right move or wrong, but the fact is this, the legal fact is this. Now I'm here, now I've been sworn in. Why don't you have a negotiated settlement? I'm serving my last term. Can we work on something that then brings us together as a country? Because I also care for my legacy, but you also care for your legacy.
All right. All right.
I think those are the perspectives that Uhuru Kenyatta must capture mm-hmm. as we move in, but let him not be distracted by the amount of demonstrations, the amount of people's assemblies, conversation around them, the amount of boycott. I think right now, silence is key.
All right.
If he ignores mm-hmm. what NASA is doing and let them do it to exhaustion, they will eventually demonstrate peacefully if they want to. People will go home at the end of the day, the boycott, people will realize that you can't boycott forever. Yeah. But if you start reacting and disrupting what NASA is doing, then you give them more legitimacy, them more claim.
All right, Bernard, and looking at the strategy for Jubilee, maybe it is because of the electioneering period that there was so much force being used on, you know, protests and all that. Should there be a change? And I mean, there are those from the civil society that say it is literally just to cow down and intimidate the opposition such that they're intimidated into silence. Should that strategy be changed? And do you think that at this point then, Jubilee and the police force in that matter should allow the protests to go on, albeit do what is constitutionally required, and that is just to provide security.
Yeah. Gitonga, thank you very much. I'll start by saying that politics is about authoritative allocation of resources. And this country, as Steve has said, is divided in the middle. So there are people, a section of the population that has invested largely in the opposition, both materially and emotionally. And these people are looking at the direction at which the opposition or the leader of opposition is going to lead them. And so it's upon the government or the president-elect to ensure that the opposition zones or people who are supporting the opposition are also included in the governance structures of this country. Back to your question about use of excessive force. Mm. This is something that has been witnessed all over again. Mm-hmm. And I think the police service, as it's called, is not really willing to change strategy. Mm-hmm. Because you can't promote peace or you can't have a peaceful demonstration mm-hmm. when through the use of force. You can't use force to quell, you know, a demonstration. This is something that has been proven all over the world, that if you want to control a crowd that is engaging in demonstrations, mm-hmm. there are approaches that the police need to devise and, you know, try to apply, mm-hmm. other than shooting
and killing.
Trying to kill.
Although, according to what I listened to, I had Eric right there in studio on Tuesday, and one of the things he was saying is the fact that, first of all, we are coming from history where demonstrations have been violent, yeah. and this is because mm-hmm. of the single-party politics, but we have now changed. However, we also see a police service that engages and is even willing to throw stones,
yeah,
really.
Is it
down to training? Is it down to maybe orders from the top that are saying, you know, that we need to ensure that these protests do not continue?
I think as much as we might want to blame the actions of the police, but I meant to understand that the junior police officers receive instructions from those people in charge or their seniors. And the instruction they are given, they are only supposed to apply. And I think it's a high time that maybe we need to change, as a country, we need to change strategy in terms of training and also the caliber of the police force, that police servicemen that you are recruiting. Mm. Because when we were in school or in our family, that maybe one person did not perform well in school, is saying, our son or our daughter, akupita mtihani, sasa wacha tumtafutie, we look for him a job with the police force. You know, this is something that even as citizens from the village level or from the family level, we look at it as an option for failure, or somebody who has not performed well, then let him go to the other side. So I think we need to reconstruct this narrative, and if possible, start hiring police from those people who have had, you know, some trainings. And I think there's some kind of recruitment going on from the people who have graduated. And, you know, when we change that narrative of police service and ensure that we now have people who are credible, people who have, you know, some intellect to perform their duties, then the narrative will change.
All right. But, and I don't know if it's down to training, because we do know that the police have actually engaged in several training missions in trying to, to change the police service. But that doesn't seem to have worked. Then again, there's a question as to whether they are actually just obeying orders from above.
Gitonga, thank you for that, because I want us to disabuse the notion that the police are uninformed. You know, about the basic human rights standards during law enforcement.
There must be some rules of engagement.
Mr. Charles Owino, if he's watching, he sure does know that I've also trained police officers on law and human rights standards during law enforcement. So they have been trained, they have been well equipped. But I think because of the perception that we have not disinherited the old thought that police can be held to account for their actions, they continue to operate. To apply excessive force even where it's not necessary. Well, I have a suggestion for Kenyans. We have to begin to document this and sue those individual officers and the chain command up to the IG. So when you have so many cases of human rights violations, use of excessive force in court, and the government losing a lot of money in compensation for people who are injured, can you imagine what Kenya National Commission on Human Rights documented as use of excessive force during the electioneering period? If all those people, if all those cases found their way in court, and the court found those cases to have merit, the government would have to pay a huge amount of money in compensation. Perhaps the language the government can understand is that of money. If it's just losing money that it have otherwise applied development, then they might say, hey, listen, we better start acting in compliance, doing what we know, as we have been trained to act in compliance. I want to mention something. You know, although the National Police Service is independent, it's an organ, the police is an organ of the executive. The ultimate responsibility remains the president. And I want to tell the president, since he likes talking about development, I want us to reframe the question of development to look at development as freedom. First of all...
Allow me to pause you because I want us to listen into what the president had to say. In his first speech that he gave yesterday after the election was upheld, he basically was appealing to the opposition to stop politicking. And let's listen into that. Then we can now focus it on that and look at what is really development. So this is what the president and his deputy had to say.
Awamu ya kufanya kazi. Tulikwenda kwa wananchi kutoka MCA, wabunge, maseneta, magavana, rais. Sote tukasema tuko na agenda ya kubadilisha taifa letu la Kenya. Sasa nafasi ya mashindano na siasa imekwisha. Nafasi iliyoko sasa ni sisi wote kufanya kazi kwa ushirikiano ili tuweze kubadilisha maisha ya wananchi wa taifa letu la Kenya. Ile tunawauliza wanasiasa wote wa Kenya ni kwamba sasa ni nafasi ya sisi wote, bila ya kujali tumechaguliwa na chama gani, bila ya kujali tumetoka sehemu gani, ni nafasi yetu sasa ya kujenga daraja za urafiki, undugu, umoja katika kazi ya kupeleka taifa letu mbele kwa maendeleo.
Hatuwezi kuishi na kukula siasa. Wakati wafika tuseme tumetosha. Siasa tumepiga. Wananchi wamechagua. Wewe kama ulikuwa na mambo yako, hiyo sasa limeisha. Njoo tufanye kazi jameni. Au ni namna gani? Kwa sababu wa Kenya hawatakula siasa. Hatutakuwa na nafasi hapa kila siku. Oh, sasa ni katiba. Oh, sasa sijui ni nini. Oh, sasa. Jamani ni katiba miaka mitano bado na sala tayari tunasema tubadilishe tena. Hey, wa Kenya wanataka tuhakikishe ya kwamba tumeweka ugali kwa meza. Watoto wao wamesoma. Hospitali tumejenga. Barabara tumejenga. Mwa Kenya pahali popote alipo ameunganishwa na stima. Vijana wetu wamepata kazi. Tuko na usalama wa kutosha. Ndio wa Kenya wawe wanatembea bila kuogopa. Jamani haya ndio mambo yale ya muhimu. Lakini sio ati kila saa is a political debate. Na kuambia siku hizi hata mimi nimechoka kuangalia TV. Ni ya nini? Hata kusoma gazeti. Kila saa, kila siasa. Sijui mtu anajiita analyst. Kama ulikuwa hii analyst hii kila siku. Na siasa, unanalyze nini? Au si tumechoka jameni? Si tumechoka jameni? Tuataka sasa kuangalia mbele.
All right, so that's what the president had to say in his deputy regarding the opposition basically coming back to the negotiation table and stop politicking. And, you know, we maybe need to deconstruct that one. What is politics, really? Because politics might be what drives us every day. But I cut you short when you were just explaining and you were saying that there is a call for the stop of politics and development. But the question is, isn't politics part and enshrined in that part of development?
Well, politics is an inextricable component of development. So we can't do without it. It's a necessary component because politics is about discussion, disagreement,
consensus. Is there a difference between politics and politicking?
Well, either is, you see, what I want the president to focus on is this. I want to give him three low-hanging fruits that does not require much effort. If you reframe development as freedom, first of all, you say that in my term, this five-year term, you will proactively respect, recognize and respect the freedom of assembly and association. So that means, and you communicate that to your team. Make sure, as much as it depends on you, do not stifle rights, you know, of Kenyans. If we, over the 5 years period, if we start assessing that people are able to express themselves freely, they're able to communicate without having to fear being censored, freedom of the media, freedom of assembly and association, then, in the context of the East African region, we can say that Kenya has truly developed. That's a very low indicator that is easily achievable. Mm. The second level of development that he must also capture is freedom from hunger, freedom from disease, access to education, Article 43 rights. Inasmuch as it depends on this government to channel resources to improve the people who are to reduce the number of Kenyans going to bed hungry, to improve access to education, quality healthcare. That is what Kenyans are. And that means that a prudent and parsimonious application of our resources. And it means also, number three, that in terms of encouraging or improving accountability, if in this five-year term, Kenyans are able to interrogate the order of the technique of governance, he's able to communicate with clarity the programs and policies that he's implementing and allowing Kenyans to hold him to account and not to say that nitafanya nini, you get that kind of that. There's a lot you can do in terms of improving open governance, making sure that the common mwananchi has a detailed understanding of what is doing it. And it's very easy to break down the order of governance. All these ministries, let them communicate in a very simple term what is it they're doing, where are the areas of collaboration with county governments, so that people can say that truly within this five-year term, in terms of accessing government information, because you have the Access Information Act, let the government proactively release information of programs and activities. Once, you know, again, corruption, Mr. Gitonga, is a question of perception. If you run the government in an opaque manner where people don't know what you're doing, even if you make an honest mistake, it will be framed as corruption. But if you're able to communicate with clarity every single step of the way, and you're able to be held accountable, it will reduce opportunities for agitation or for litigation. All right. I think those are the broad frameworks, and these are issues that are not necessarily money-oriented, except the socioeconomic rights that require huge capital investment. Securing freedoms, the critical freedoms, does not require any money. It just requires a proactive, matching political culture that, as a president, I will allow them. But that does not mean that he vacates his responsibility to track. He can track what the political opposition is doing and see how to escalate the level of response. And the manner of escalation, Mr. Gitonga, should not rely on raw power or fear. I think the Jubilee administration in the first term did not use the court so well.
even this government is allowed to go to court and present their case to court and say, listen, we are trying to implement certain activities and programs,
and we are being hindered from doing that.
The political climate is so hostile and so poisonous that we can hardly work. Could you please give us direction on the limits that opposition can go? And then when the court frames the issue for the opposition, they are able to then implement that court order within that framework that the court has defined, not right. imagining what you think is right, and then now running the risk of going beyond what may be considered as excessive use of force.
All right. Bernard, they say perception is reality. And when the president is saying stop politicking, calling on the opposition to stop politicking, maybe he doesn't mean stop politics. Maybe he means stop the demonstration, stop the things that are possibly infringing on the rights of other Kenyans as you go about your business.
Yeah, Mr. Gitonga, a human being by nature is a political animal. We engage in politics on our daily, activities. We involve politics in everything. What I think the president was talking about is the issue to do with the constructive politics. You know, we have both the destructive and constructive politics. So, but it's the responsibility of the opposition to ensure that it puts the government in check. If the opposition does not politic or does not criticize what the government is doing, then we'll have this excessive appliance of politics from the government side. So the opposition is in its nature supposed to criticize and inform the public on the excesses from the on the part of the government. But one thing that I would like to mention is that when the opposition now goes overboard, like trying to make everything that the government does and associate it with politics.
But how is it overboard, given that as long as it's within the confines of the Constitution? For instance, if it is the freedom to picket or to express yourselves and even march, that is within the Constitution. Yeah, why is it overboard?
The Constitution allows for citizens to picket and protest or express themselves. But we have scenarios where now these purported peaceful demonstrations of picketing is engaged into issues of hooliganism, destruction of property. Remember, your rights ends where mine begins. So if your rights as a picketer is
infringing on mine,
I have the responsibility of going to court or, crying over the government to protect my rights. And in doing so, that's when we see now the police coming in and trying to shoot. In the past, we have seen police force using rubber bullets. I don't know what has happened that we now see live bullets being, applied in a demonstration process. And if the government can actually, instead of buying so many live bullets, if they can invest in rubber bullets, it will make things better, as in it will not kill. It will only cause harm on you. Or some cause of pain.
I mean, we've seen those huge trucks that are supposed to, shower you, as it were. I don't know why they prefer to use live bullets instead.
What we've seen is that there's lack of coordination between the executive, the presidency, and the constitutional commissions.
Yeah.
If there was better collaboration, then you'd say, because then it would, the government would get additional, objective, dispassionate view. For instance, the Kenya National Commission on Human Rights, which will then say, in fact, KNCHR, together with IPOA, they ran a very very nice advert on TV about the right to picket and telling you as a Kenyan that you also have responsibilities. I think that was a good message that did not come from the executive or the presidency. If there was collaboration and saying that, listen, government, our approach in this term is not to stifle the exercise or the enjoyment of fundamental rights and freedoms, but we also plead and pray that Kenyans will do so responsibly. Now, the idea of communicating the responsibility to Kenyans can be a shared agenda, where you say, if Eric Raida was, for instance, flanked by Kagwiri Mbogoria of KNCHR, and let's say someone from GEC, National Gender and Equality Commission, because in these demos, women and children are issued most of the time, they're affected.
Then you have a broader
team communicating the same message that, listen, this time we want to see a more decisive approach in terms of managing demonstration, because you can't stifle them, you can't stop them. But we've also seen that what I was saying, that we need to disinherit from our past. There's been there's been instances, in fact, several instances of people starting within the law, but then veering off the law, of the manipulating law. A constitutional provision.
Just to add on what Steve has
said. And we're out of time. We need to wind up.
Just briefly.
Yeah, very briefly.
Mm. Yeah, it's not the responsibility of picketing organizers to ensure the security of the picketers and those who are, you know, and those who are not participating in the demonstration. Their responsibility is only to inform the police that we are going to hold this picketing, we are going to hold this function. So it's upon the police
to provide the security that is required
to both the demonstrators and those who are not participating in
the
demonstration.
All right, gentlemen, sorry we have to wind up there. I'm told that really we are out of time. And KTN Home is live today. I mean, rather, is taking up Life and Style Begins Now. So we need to release them. And those of us on KTN News, do stay with us. We've got more stories making headlines. And also, remember, we're going to be focusing on the NSSF later on as we let you know how you can benefit as they hold their AGM today at the KICC, which is why we're coming to you live. So for KTN Home, we say goodbye. KTN News, we take a short break. We'll be right back.